I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Are there additions to the agenda, Becky?
Yes, I would like to add between 1 and 2, Sheriff Dingman for a resolution for a radio grant. And then to number 11, I'd like to add MOA, MOU for additional county attorney services, a personnel committee update, and County Ditch 16 change order.
Okay. Madam Chair, with those changes, I move to approve the agenda.
I second.
Motion and second to approve the amended agenda. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. And the minutes from the August 1st meeting were in your packet. I found 2 corrections that I've shown Becky. So with those corrections, is there a motion to approve?
I'll make that motion.
I'll second it.
Thank you. Motion and second to approve the amended minutes. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Public comments? Hearing none, we'll go on to Jason. Good morning.
Good morning, all. So Donna asked me to come to present this to you. She had a different obligation this morning, and there's kind of a time crunch on this. It's for a grant through the ECN for some radio equipment, but it requires a 50-50 match. And in order to submit the grant, we have to have a resolution saying that we would pay our share of it. And that share will be a little less than $10,000, but we have that in 290. That's where we would pay it from. So,
and this is for dispatch equipment, correct?
Yeah, it's for replacement of consoles for our dispatch radio, which are, I think they're almost 10 years old now. So.
And this is also going to Emergency Service Board, Central Board, because we discussed at our last meeting that we are a recipient of this grant.
So. Yep. So I guess all I'm asking you guys to...
Madam Chair, I'll make a motion to approve the resolution.
I'll second that.
Motion and second to approve the radio grant with the 50% match. All those in favor say aye.
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 Opposed? Motion carries.
Thank you. Thanks, Amy.
Same one as thank you.
Well, thank you
so much for having us here today. Good morning again. And I'm here to present the 2022 Viking Library System Annual Report and the 2024 appropriation request. Dive right in with a little recap of who we are and who we serve. The Viking Library System has 6 member counties. Those are Douglas, Grant, Otter Tail, Pope, Stevens, and Traverse. And we serve 11 member libraries within those 6 counties. 2022 was Viking Library System's 47th year of providing regional public library services. And Stevens County was one of the original signatories to our 1975 charter. A little bit about how we serve. Viking Library System is a federated library system, one of 12 systems in the state. And our mission is to connect, promote, and strengthen library services in West Virginia. We accomplish our mission by providing essential services to member libraries that are governed and administered locally, as well as direct services to rural residents and select communities, such as long-term care and child care facilities and schools. And we do that through our bookmobile and outreach services. Some highlights from 2022. The bookmobile provides 4 stops in Stevens County. And in 2022, the bookmobile circulated 1,666 items at those 4 stops. We also provide every other day every other weekday delivery to the member libraries in Stevens County. And a collective total of 24,799 items rotated between the two libraries in 2022. In 2022, the system also received some ARPA funds. And one of the projects we completed with those funds is a three-year strategic plan. And in the packet I handed out, you'll see our one-pager included. And we prioritize some activities as a result of that strategic plan in 2023. And those include improving system-wide communication, using digital tools, increased bookmobile marketing, increased professional training for our member library staff, and completion of an organizational study and compensation study. The organizational analysis process also dovetails with several staffing changes that Viking Library System saw in 2022. We celebrated the retirement of long-term employees that had a collective total of over 8 years of service to the system. And we also welcomed new team members to the system as well. So a lot of change. I'd like to just switch gears a little bit and talk about our shared funding model. Just like we share services amongst the six counties, we share how those services are funded. And so funding for providing residents of the system area is shared among member cities, member counties, and the state. And member counties provide funding for the bookmobile service, non-resident reimbursement to the member libraries, delivery and interlibrary loan, the automated library system, and technical network and professional consulting and administrative support for the member libraries within the system. State funding provides dollars for Viking Library System administration and facilities expenses, and also broadband and internet service and the equipment associated with that, e-resources and content, outreach services to group homes and child cares within the system area, and funding for local arts, history, and cultural events, and professional consulting services to the member libraries. During the 2023 legislative session, I'm happy to report that the systems in Minnesota received an increase in Regional Library Basic System Support, or RLBSS. Probably heard that acronym before if you've been, you've heard my recap before, and my predecessors as well. This is a long-awaited increase, as the amount allocated to RLBSS has not increased since 2009. The Viking Library System Governing Board and Administration is referencing the service priorities outlined in the three-year strategic plan and deferred maintenance and collection needs to guide the allocation of the increased funding for 2024. Outcomes of the organizational analysis and compensation study will also guide future allocations. So we're trying to be very purposeful and strategic in how we move forward with this funding, because we know just as a quick aside, I know I don't have a lot of time, but one addition in the RLBS's increase included and also a formula change, but also annual indexing, which means that we should be able to count on a 2-3% increase annually in that funding stream as well, which will help as we plan for salary allocations out of that funding stream, since it does provide for administration expenses. And then finally, the cities. The cities provide funding for the building, materials, staff, utilities, and administrative costs for the libraries themselves, three-legged stool. And due primarily to the increase in RLBSS and a decrease in personnel expenses due to some of those staffing changes, the Viking Library System Governing Board, after discussion, approved a flat funding request for member counties for 2024. Our budget request for Stevens County for 2024 is a total of $68,736, and that's a 0% or flat increase request over 2023. I'll stop there. I do have Heidi from Hancock Community Library and Anne from Morris Public Library with me to share a little bit about the library is. And then we can answer any questions.
Well, I'll just share briefly that we had a fantastic summer reading program and just summer at the library in general. I'm still going through a lot of the numbers, but it looks like we were above pre-pandemic levels of participation in most of our events and programs. And there was also a huge increase in foot traffic. So usually at the end of July, we end our summer reading program where kids and adults turn in reading logs, and we kind of end a lot of our bigger programs. And then August, it's a little bit quiet before people go on vacation, but it has not slowed down at all. So that is very different than what I've experienced since working at the library since 2014. So it's great. It's wonderful. We're very, very busy.
Hi, I'm Heidi Linder from the Hancock Community Library. I'll agree with Anne. We had a really good summer reading program. Smaller scale than Morris, of course, but we had a very good turnout. We've been very busy with people coming and going. The thing with Hancock is we utilize a lot of the internet services. We have a lot of homeschooling. A lot of families come in to use our computers and our internet services, and they really appreciate that. Thank you for supporting the libraries.
So Heidi, in Hancock, do you have to pay your own utilities in that building and stuff?
Yeah. I'm in the same building as the city.
Oh, okay.
So it doesn't come out of my budget, the percentage.
So I have a question. How would you add a bookmobile stop if you wanted to do that?
How much to add?
How would you add?
Oh, how would you? Good question. So we actually just added a bookmobile stop in Cyrus for the summer. Typically, if someone expresses interest in a stop, we see if we can fit it somewhere in our route schedule, mm-hmm. And then we'll try it out as a summer stop to see if it's a viable, mm-hmm. it seems like something we can pursue. So it depends. And then also if it's a long-term care facility, if we can do a bag or a collection drop, so it's not necessarily a 20-minute stop, and get those in a little easier.
So I don't know if you know about our daycare pod project, but that might be a great place for you guys to stop once in a while so that all six of those daycares could take advantage of the bookmobile at the same time.
Great idea. Mm-hmm.
There may be ways that
That'd be great too.
Because mm-hmm. I was just thinking about that. How do you get 60 kids to have a library card? But maybe the daycares could have the library card or something. Yes.
That's how the schools operate.
Yep.
A lot of the classrooms hold the cards for the students.
I think that would be, and plus it would be another, they're always interested in big trucks, big things like that. So
yes.
I think that would be fun for the daycare kids to even see the bookmobile. So.
Yes.
And it's a new bookmobile, right? It's a new bookmobile?
Yes. Mm-hmm. New, so hit the road in 2021.
Mm-hmm.
So, yes.
Pretty fancy. I've seen it, and I've been in it.
Madam Chair, I have one question. So, Aaron, I see most of your projected expenses are up by a small amount, but I see administration is up like $92,000 compared to 2023. Can you answer that question for me? What the large increase is?
Yes. So RLBSS funds administrative costs, and we are, as part of our strategic plan, we are looking at hiring an HR and finance coordinator, which would be funded through regional library basic system support dollars. So that's where that primary increase comes from.
So this extra money from the legislature, that's ongoing. It's not a one-time deal.
Yes, it's ongoing. Yeah. And there,
that's what Ron was getting at too, I'm sure. That
right. Yeah.
Yeah.
And so that indexing of 2-3% will help us be able to support staff salaries as well.
We've operated on grants and stuff that once they're done, then you have to find the money. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, ladies.
Thank you.
Cheryl. Good morning.
Morning. Good morning.
Good morning.
You all have this, right? My little.
Yeah.
Yep. Kind of, just okay. By the number. A new, you guys kind of, since we're here, our new commissioner, I'll just go over, I'll start with a little bit about what we do at the Stevens County Economic Improvement Commission. First of all, I'm going to start out that just because we are a private lending organization and the work we do is under strict confidence, I apologize, but I can't speak directly to the businesses that we serve, but I can't speak vaguely about the businesses that we serve. So Pat, when you hear me talking about this business or that business, that's the reason why I cannot release exactly who we work with. Okay. So what we do is we just, our hashtag is we do business with you. The types of things that come into our office, I'm always a storyteller. Sometimes I'll get a person that comes in and says, Cheryl, I really want to be a business owner. What does Stevens County need? And so then we look at some of the assessments and some of the things that we've done and the people that we've visited with and say, well, we could maybe use this or this, but what are you interested in? And we start from that very small scale. Other times I'll have people come into my office and they're a strong technician. Let's just say they're an auto mechanic. And they want to start an auto mechanic business. What we do in our office is we coach them through, how do I start a business? What does this look like? How do I register with the Secretary of State? What licenses do we need? And we can get them packaged. If they need commercial financing, we can package them, because if a person goes for a loan at a commercial bank, they need to have a business plan in place. They need to have cash projections in place. And they need to know, basically, these are all the steps. We need their financial statements, we need their tax statements. And I can help get that all together for them so that they can go to the commercial banks. It gets to be a lot. I can handle about 5 or 6 clients at that level. The other thing then that our organization can do is we can connect them to the small business development centers, which are funded through the SBA. And they do those same types of services, just a little bit slower pace. And so we're able to get them out the door a little bit more quickly through our office. But if we are at capacity, because there are just 2 of us in the office, we also use that resource. That's the other thing that our organization does, is we stay connected into our federal and state resources. So any federal grants that are coming through, or federal loans that are coming through, federal workforce supports, business expansion supports, federal, state, and local supports, we stay connected with all of that. And so a financing package might look like, so a recent financing package looked like the lead bank, which is their commercial bank, was in at a certain amount of money. The SCEIC comes in at a certain amount of money. We'll share that position, or we'll position out to third position with West Central Initiative. There may be some grants in that or some direct loans from the SBA. So what we do is we sort of put all those puzzle pieces together to ensure that our county gets the business here. Recently, it's a good project. This was a successful project. We're still working on it. But one of the projects that was recently brought to me was a large scale business within Stevens County. They had the ability to expand their business in one of their other states or to expand their business here. When we hear that in our world, what I do then is I get on the horn with the state. And I say, we want this in Stevens County. We want the additional economic impact. We want the additional 25 employees that it will bring in to our county. How can we compete so that they don't move it to another state? So what that looks like then is, for this particular business, we have what's called a MIF financing, which is for equipment, that type of thing coming in from the state, which will be managed in our office. We also have a workforce financing for them. There'll be other financing incentives that come in. They are loans. There are some that are grants. Those grants, though, must be measured by the amount of employees they bring in and the economic impact in our county. We were successful in that competition, and now we're moving forward with those incentives to keep that business expanding in our county. That's just a little bit. And then, so that's sort of the larger scale. Another agribusiness that we've worked with, a really incredible high-tech patented new idea, needed support from our organization to go to the Department of Energy. And they needed our organization as the economic developer for the area to write a support letter
And then the other thing we had to do is we had to take a look at our census data. And in that census data, where are our poverty bases? Lay that over the top of two other data sets from the EDA where there's sort of what they call energy poverty, I think would be one way to just kind of do that. And to see if this project then would cause enough impact to be something that the the Department of Energy would want to fund at the federal level. That's still in the works. We'll see what comes of that. It's an interesting project that captures the carbon credits and those types of things. On smaller scales though, then I also have right now, or just kind of in the last month, we have two auto businesses. And then it's kind of an interesting thing sometimes because I'm working with two businesses. They both are two entrepreneurs that are both looking at one particular business. I've disclosed to both of them that I'm working with another person, but I just put that best foot forward and we'll see what they decide and what the business owner decides as to who to sell that to. Also working on a VA grant. That's a lot. The other thing though that we're working that is a really huge success point is that Main Street grant financing came out from the federal government to the state. The state then took that financing, put it into grant form for first round. I knew we couldn't be competitive first round as a county on our own because I knew the other incentive, or it's like West Central, Southwest, the other regions were applying as a region. Could not get West Central to go on the first round. On the second round, I really hammered hard and made a lot of phone calls and dogged it so that our fiscal host is West Central Initiative. However, our organization wrote and were funded $1.2 million. Those $1.2 million are direct funds that are being used currently on our Atlantic Avenue in Morris, down Highway 28, which is our corridor that needed to be identified. There are nine businesses within that corridor that applied for the funding. We had a citizens board, including myself, come through or look at all of it, and that funding is currently being worked on through West Central Initiative. One of the most interesting stories about that, and that will become public, but at this point I can't talk specifically, but we were very close to losing one of our franchised businesses in town. As a franchise business, they are required every so many years to upgrade everything in their business. And this particular business was going to pull out of Stevens County. We encouraged them to apply for the Main Street financing, which pays for 30% of all development and redevelopment. And we're hoping that'll keep them in the county. And they did win that award. So we're hoping that'll keep them in the county. So that's a little bit about what we do and some of the things that we're working on. Right now, we're also working on a federal EDA. We had our disaster declaration that we received. And because of that, we have some large end capacity users. Those end capacity users and future expansion areas need water and sewer infrastructure. So we're working with the federal EDA, writing a federal grant right now that could be up to $5 million. It pays for half the cost of water and sewer infrastructure because we have those commercial end capacity users, which would be really nice, but we'll see how that works. We'll just go with that. So then by the numbers, I always go through this with you guys. So for as far as workforce retentions, and you guys have this in front of you, but I'll just review it. We retain 39 jobs. That's direct support either through our lending or else through workforce development initiatives within our office. We have 35 new jobs this year that we brought into the county, 25 new jobs that we're currently working on with some larger companies. We talked a little bit about how we got the state involved to compete to keep that expansion within our county. We wrote 7 new loans and we have 2 loans that paid off. We're currently managing a book of 26 loans and there's over probably 120 loans that we've had in the time frame of the SCEIC. This year, I've worked with over 26 potential and existing businesses. And we talked a little bit about, so business plans, cash flow projections, marketing, logo designs, reading financial statements, social media, all of the things that succession planning was kind of big. I have two green lines businesses that they've owned the businesses, a family business for years. How do we sell that? What do we need to do? What does that look like? And so working with those business owners to make sure that that business changes hands as a benefit to both the new owner and the old owner so that the doors don't have to close. Talked about the Main Street grant funding at $1.2 million, and then I wrote and was awarded another $100,000 in relanding dollars. With the way the economy is right now and with the bank rates going up and up and up, it makes commercial lending a bit more risky for the banks. And what we do then is we come in that second position and we can close that gap. And we're running out of money to lend, but we're working on that. We have a few different avenues. So that $100,000 will help us quite a bit in money to lend out. We also receive back in about $10,000 a month that comes back in from loan payments. So that's a good thing that kind of is continually replenishing. We have federal and state reporting because we have federal and state dollars. So the federal government and the state government both come to our office and look through our files and make sure that we're in compliance with everything. We also do an audit every year. I was on the child care committee as a member and business representative, and yay, thank you all so much, commissioners, because child care has huge impact on workforce. Workforce is what we need to keep our business and our business economy alive in Stevens County. So that is, thank you very much for your work on that. I talked a little bit about that. One of the things that we do that I don't think people understand is that we have what we call open spaces, and it's a system called LOIS. And we work with site selectors. So let's just say that Target, Target's probably not going to come to Stevens County, at least not for a while. But Target has real estate people or site selectors. And if they're looking for an area of expansion, they go on to LOIS. And they can see every region of the country and internationally. We make sure that all the spaces in Stevens County are updated. And so that when they look, they know that we have spaces available and what they look like. We also keep a business listserv. So I talked about all of those. And I think each of you are on it. If you're not, let me know. You'll get an email from us that'll say, hey, this is what's going on for businesses right now. If you've got this workforce or if you need this technical assistance or whatever it is, we're continually rolling that out without becoming too much of a nuisance. And then we also work really hard to keep our professional certifications up and to keep kind of our noses in the readings. So I'm part of BOAT, which is statewide, and MAPS, which is statewide. I'm part of the Regional Economic Development Board, and I serve on the Small Business Development Advisory Board. And my certification is complete, so I'm a certified professional economic developer. When you go back in the history, we were flat for about 3 years or 4 years in a row, and there was a reduction in financing from the county prior to my coming on board. And so we're doing a little bit of catch up so fiscal year last year, we had the county board for 67,000. This year, we're asking for 69,500. And that's about 20%. And that is pretty much just cost of living. As you know, everything's much more expensive within our organization.
I have a question.
Any questions? Yes, Bob.
Is there any talk of any more industrial park area? And if you could wave your magic wand, could you go in the water? Projects, we have places for sewer and water for people to build.
I can't talk specifically to the sewer and water project that we're working on right now. I can't talk specifically about that, but that is that federal EDA grant that pays for 50% of that. And that is within the city of Morris and to some outlying projects. The industrial park is very difficult. And I get asked this every time I come before the board. At one point, we did have three different 1031 agriculture exchanges in place, and we were going to put an industrial park on the north side. Mm-hmm. As you know, Riley Brothers is that gravel pit on the south side. They're willing, or I guess, I don't know who owns that one now. I don't know who that went to exactly, but they're willing to move out of that space if we can find them another gravel pit. Very difficult. Yeah, Ron is laughing. He knows exactly. And then what we did is we had an exchange to get some land on the north side, which is nice because it's also in our opportunity zone, which would have been great. However, the person right in the middle in the exchanging of all the properties that need to go on decided that their property was much higher value than what they were getting in exchange. So the whole thing blew up. And now the people at play trying to find that land, I'll take anybody's help at this point because I work on it constantly because we do need it. At one point, because of the federal disaster declaration, we could have had 80% of an industrial park infrastructure paid for.
Oh my God.
And that's when we were going through that exchange, and that's what blew up, which just is like, oh.
Yeah, we certainly need to, if you don't have space, people won't move.
I mean, we do have some development properties around the county, the in-county in general. We do have some development properties, but we do, a lot of people are saying, oh, these open spaces that we have on Main Street, we need open spaces. That's how we grow and build. So I understand exactly what you're saying, Bob, and I wish, if anybody knows, let me know. Any
other questions for Cheryl?
Cheryl.
Thank you, Cheryl.
Thank you.
Didn't need my pen today.
I did.
Brought your own.
Darn. What was I thinking? I brought a pen.
You weren't.
I wasn't.
Now we'll welcome Steve and Ryan. Good morning.
Morning. Good morning. But Steve to have his rolling chin. All right, good morning. May have known, maybe not. My name is Ryan, Steve Stork, we're with the Stevens County Fair. We're here today to talk a little bit about the fair. First, we're going to give some updates as our fair just ended on Sunday. We had the fair supper, a little over 800 people came and enjoyed the meal. The trip winner did come forward the next morning. Wednesday was the Ribs and Rides that Superior Industry in Westmore sponsors. Very well attended. We had a lot of people on the grounds. Each year it seems to get bigger and bigger, which is fantastic. Thursday we had the Enduro. As you all know, the weather was not cooperative in the afternoon and evening. We had a little over 305 people attend the Enduro race that night. Which is down from prior years, but with the rain and weather, we did get most of the race in, but we did end up closing the fairgrounds early because of the thunderstorms and so forth. So Friday night was Diamond Reel, something new we tried here in Stevens County, and it was a huge success. We had 1,500 tickets sold, and roughly the number. And it was great weather and a fantastic turnout. If you were out to the grounds, there was, like I said, 1,500 people on one side of the grandstand, and at least that on the other side of the grandstand, enjoying food and beverage and having a good time with fellowship. So that was good to see. Saturday, we had the rodeo. We had 1,450 people roughly at the rodeo, which isn't a record, but still a very, very good turnout for an event. We did have the weather turned out to be very nice. Lots of ropers and barrel racers. Sunday was the demo derby. It was a rainy afternoon. We had 900 people that fit into the grandstand. That is kind of what that grandstand will hold. Roughly, we could probably fit a few more, but with the rain, it was a tight fit. We did get the whole demolition derby in. You know, we got what, 3 inches of rain on Sunday, and the demo went all the way through. Very happy to have the demo get in and get everybody out to the fairgrounds. The carnival did have to close down a little earlier than they wanted to, but I think it was a complete success all around the whole fair. Another highlight this year was the scooters that we had, a huge support on that. The fair did write a grant through the state of Minnesota to help pay for the majority of the scooters. So the fair didn't pay for all of them, and we greatly appreciated the grant that we got through the state of Minnesota to purchase the 5 scooters. We did charge a little bit to rent them out. The rental is going to be used to offset what our cost was, and then also for prior maintenance or for future maintenance of it. We did have to end up paying for a few things that we didn't get in the original purchase. So We did buy some extra batteries, just because, as you all know, as years go on, the batteries don't tend to last as long. So now we'll be able to change out those batteries and be able to use them all day long. But food booths, I think every food vendor out there was very happy. If you were on the fairgrounds anytime after 11 o'clock, 12 o'clock and saw the garbage, you would see that food was very well received out there, and every garbage can was full each night. So entertainment, the free stage entertainment, everybody comes out for and enjoys, which is great. The circus was new this year. We haven't had them in a few years. We did have the same circus a few years ago. This year they came back with a bigger and better show. Very happy with how the circus turned out. On the carnival side, the Tilt-A-Whirl was our new attraction this year, very well received. Talking with Greg and Gail, the Tilt-A-Whirl hasn't been out for a few years. And we did ask Greg that if he could bring it for our 150th. And so he brought it. It is very labor intensive to set up, take down. So they don't take it everywhere just because labor is a definite shortage, seems like everywhere, just not in Morris.
It's the same thing about a Ferris wheel?
Ferris wheel.
Outdated, or are they gone, or?
They, well, there might be an attraction next year. It might come the next year.
Just curious, because you drive by down the highway, you look for the fair. And
You look for the fair. Yeah. Yes. I think they're in negotiations for possibly one. We'll see.
Greg did tell me that they did order one.
Okay.
It comes from overseas. There's delivery date, but there's no guarantees on that delivery date, you know, happen. But if it is on the delivery date as scheduled, we will see that at the fair next year, but with a lot of time between now and then. So.
And there's a lot of water between where the Ferris wheel's got to come. So.
Yeah.
Some of the improvements that were done in this year, we did tile, do some tiling project with Woof Tiling in the carnival area, the parking lot, and then behind the schoolhouse, trying to capture some of those wet areas that typically have been very wet for us. The rest cottage, as you know, was a new building out to the fairgrounds. We would like to thank again the Chicago Alberta School that helped us build it. We paid for the material. Chicago School built it, and then we had to do a little bit of finish work in it because the school ended a little earlier than we anticipated. So concrete improvements and additions. We improved sidewalks. There is concrete underneath that rest cottage. You know, every fair goer and people that come from different counties is just amazed how much concrete we have, you know, nice it is for wheelchairs and for handicapped, or even, you know, parents with strollers are just loving the concrete that we have. The new overhead door in the poultry barn, in the back side, we put a new overhead door. We took the sliding doors off. One of the doors, seemed like every time you opened it, we had to crawl back up and put it back on the track. So now we have a new overhead door back there. The red shed, which used to be the old kitty barn, we put an overhead door in that one. That one, once it snows and we get a little ice, it is shut for the winter. Now we'd be able to get into it much easier. We did some fence upgrades by the schoolhouse and by the deer hunters. With that windstorm we got a few weeks ago, part of our fence blew over. Now it is well put together now. We did put in or built 12 new picnic tables. The Hancock School helped us with that, with the welding program over at Hancock. We paid for materials and then they helped us weld it, which was a great partnership with the Hancock School. Along with new water lines in the beef barn. And then the other big concrete project was in the back part of the sheep barn. That's all been concreted to help kids that have the sheep projects and goat projects. Looking into 2024, we do have some electrical upgrades that we need to do as our infrastructure has gotten a little bit older and aging, and then also doing some improvements as our fair has grown. We do need to increase some electrical outlets in power in different areas of the fairgrounds. We would also like to tin the lower part of the poultry building, which is the tin building, the gray building in the middle of the fairgrounds. If you were to look on the bottom of that building, years ago, it was rented to a company that stored chemical and fertilizer in it, and they must have had a slow leak. But there's a little bit of rust on the bottom. The concrete in there at some point in time would need to be replaced too, but we're not looking at that at this point. But the tin, right now we've painted it a couple different times, and we feel that to help the cosmetic side of the building, and also with the holes that are in the side of the tin to keep rodents and so forth out of it, tinning that lower part of the building would really improve. And as that entrance to the fair has also increased for foot traffic, we feel that the cosmetic side of it would also be a benefit. Concrete, again, to sidewalks, adding in the backside of the beef barn next to the new sheep, they'd like to put a concrete wash rack in. It is there's tile there already, but it's kind of turned into a mud hole with the rain. And by putting some concrete in there, it would really clean that up, and then also allow the sheep project to have an area to wash. So. And then looking at the beef tiles in the back, gating is needed. Right now, we have an individual or farm that has been letting us borrow some portable gates. They let us know that this year that they would no longer be willing to do that at this point in time, just because they are in need of those gates and they're having to move their animals around just to compensate us. So. The other thing too is, as our fair is growing and our crew looking at safety, looking at like a man basket or a man lift to help hang flags, light bulbs, signs around the fairgrounds. We have been renting a lift, and it's worked well, but the logistics of renting and borrowing has been getting a little hard. We feel that that would be beneficial year round for us to, if we could possibly purchase one. But the other upgrades would be possible plumbing upgrades to the south bathroom. Right now, that is the older bathroom, the concrete bathroom. It's all copper piping. Each year we put a band-aid on a project that really should be replumbed and redone. The piping in the back has leaked numerous times. We do have an individual on the fair board that is a certified plumber willing to help. So it's really materials. But as you know, materials are not cheap whatsoever. But and then possibly tinning the south bathroom, the outside of it, just trying to clean it up a little bit. That bathroom gets used a lot by the carnival and for fair going. And as our fairgrounds gets used more and more, not just necessarily for the fair, but different events, we feel that this would be a great asset to do to improve those bathrooms a little bit more. So right now our request, we are very grateful for the $36,000 that we've been getting from you guys. We would like to see if it'd be possible, because of the increase in garbage, water, our entertainment costs, and just general operating costs, if we could get an increase to $40,000. And we haven't asked for much of an increase over the years. We did ask last year for some. We do realize budgets are tight, but as the old adage goes, if you don't ask, you don't receive. So, any questions?
I have a comment. First of all, it was a wonderful fair. And second of all, the park and ride at the school, what a great thing. I hope you continue that, and I hope you actually extend it to the daytime hours as well, because that was the slickest thing for people to be able to just park there, and with the buses going like they were, that was a really...
And on that, I mean, we did it on Friday and Saturday as kind of a test.
Yep.
We did give counters to the bus drivers so that they could keep track of how many people. Ryan probably has a number on that. I did not hear what it was.
I didn't know.
You know, because it costs us good money to do it. And we figured we'd try it as a test, see how it works, the fact that we have it. And this year, I'm sure it would catch on a lot more for the future years or whatever, too.
Yeah. So. I think the comment that I heard was people didn't know about it, you know? And so once they were aware of it, they said that was a really slick deal. And then where they dropped off at the new dairy barn, that was, you're right down there with the food and the Lee Center and stuff. So that was a great addition, I think.
And we did have one of the fair board members actually hop on the park and ride just to see, you know, the logistics and what we need to do for future if we continue it, to, you know, so we know the little. And I know she talked about some of the signage that we had, maybe moving the location, making things a little bit more understanding for somebody that's coming here new. But
The other thing is I sit in the schoolhouse every year on Sunday, and there was a couple came down from Fargo because they saw the fair online and they thought this looked like a, I don't know how they got home in the rain. I hope they got home before it rained so hard, but because they were on motorcycles. But so we truly draw people from all over because it is such a nice fair. So thanks for what you do.
And we do see that somewhat from the vendors that call us and say, we'd like to have a booth in your commercial building or whatever, because the word is getting out that Stevens County Fair is something you need to go to. And that's where the vendors are coming back and saying, we want to be part of your fair because we know what you draw there. So
one of the vendors that we did have was Research on a Stick, which was in the Lee Center. In talking to the gal that kind of helped set that up, she has researchers from Winona, Minneapolis, Duluth, that they have a sign-up sheet and they have a waiting list for these people to come. Because last year was the first time that the researchers came. Now this year, she said, I had 12 slots and I had 30 people that wanted to come. So she said, this is phenomenal. And every one of them was like, I never even knew where Morse was until I came out here. And they all love it. I've had a couple different individuals from outside the area that have said, you know, they're really impressed with how well the fair is set up. And, you know, kudos to the fair board. And, you know, Steve and I are just two people on the board, but we have a great crew that works very hard behind the scenes to get everything done. So, but again, we thank you for your guys' support, and we hope that you continue the support to Stevens County Fair. And, I've seen every one of you out to the fair. Hopefully every one of you has enjoyed it and are full of fair food and ready to talk about next year. So,
I know the wrestlers went through 7,700 pounds of potatoes that they turned into fries. It was up from last year. So
I think most of the food vendors out there, we did remind them that this was 150th. We expected more people. They all upped their number.
Yep.
And I know numerous ones that ran out of food, even though that number went up. So I wish we could have a number of how many people actually eat at the fair. You know, kind of a, we compare ourselves to different area counties that do charge, and they do a report to the Minnesota Federation of how many people come to their fair. So we kind of say, okay, if you had this, we had this. So
one of the downfalls of having a free fair,
you
can only attend.
No way to come.
But that's why people come, because it's free.
Because it is free, and they come out there multiple times a day. They come out at lunchtime, they, you know, and that all makes that circle happen.
Like I said, though, I think that park and ride was a good thing. And because on any given day, I always come for the church service on Sunday morning, so I get a good parking spot on Sundays for sure. But other than that, it's really a crapshoot as far as if you're going to get to park within a mile. So
I think the first day, the number I heard was 200 people on the park and ride.
Oh.
Second day was about 125.
Okay.
And like I said, it's new, and people didn't really know
about
it. So I think that will get increased.
Right. And we just try something new.
Yep.
It could work. It was just an idea of one of the fair board members.
I thought it was great.
And things that you guys don't see, and the general public doesn't really see until it actually happens, is like the Thursday night storm event. Our planning from previous times, and we had a plan in place. Mm-hmm. For certain thresholds that happened, would have continued that plan. But when we decided to close down the fairgrounds, we had a plan. We got people out of there and very quick order, and you know,
worked close with Donna and Jason Dingman, and made sure that everything was safe and sound. So
there were more plans had it when actually went into a warning. So
I originally were talking 70-mile-per-hour winds, and I went into one food vendor, and I was dreading having to tell her that she'd have to close her food stand down. And she came back the next day and she said, you made the right decision, even though the wind didn't happen, but the rain. So everybody came back on Friday and had a good time. So
yep.
Any other questions for us?
Thank you, guys.
Thanks for having me.
Thank you. Have a great day.
Pam. Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning. Sorry, I'm not offering. Good morning, Donnie.
Good morning.
You're welcome. Thank you. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
I'm Cam Erickson, the director at the Stevens County Historic Museum. Mary DeVita, our board president, was not able to come with me today, so I'm solo. I know you can all read, so I'm not going to read verbatim what I just handed you. But I gave you a highlight sheet. On the back is probably what you've already seen a few weeks ago, but I thought I'd just stick it there anyway. I also gave you a newsletter from the last edition of our newsletter, and inside of the newsletter is a card in case you want to become a member of the Historical Society. So I want to thank you, first of all, for your support last year and all of the previous years. We couldn't do what we do without that support. We are completely reliant on townships, county, individual donations, fundraising. We live on faith completely all the time. We have had some individuals who have given us estate gifts for a length of time. And this last year we realized we don't really get notified, but that one came to an end. So that happened to be the one we were using to pay on our loan. So we're just always relying on the next gift or the, you know, things like that. So just a few points of like what your support allows us to do. One of the things that we started the last year and a half, our one Thursday evening per month programming, it allows people to come to that without paying an admission cost. Excuse me. And we've been trying to hit a lot of different topics. We try to hit all the communities. We've had a Chicago night. We've had different townships. So we try to cover the whole county. We try to get everyone involved. Now, whether or not the greater county people take advantage of what their tax dollars are doing, that's up to them. We like to encourage people to come and take part of what we're offering. But it's been a really great place for people to connect and share stories and whatnot. We've had probably double the amount of research requests this last year than we've ever had. I'm not sure what that's all about, if people are just more into genealogy right now, or if COVID did that, or I don't know. Last week we had a man come, gave me a sticky note. He wanted two obituaries. I was there by myself. I said, well, we'll have to have our researchers do that a different day, and we'll mail it to him and whatever. And he wrote his address down, and it said Brewster, which is down by Worthington. And then I found out he actually drove from Brewster just for those two obituaries. to Morris just to get those. So we dug those out for him and whatnot. He had to help be the receptionist while he was there in order to do that. So people are coming, they're emailing us. We got a request from Germany. They're coming the middle of September. So we have that one kind of ready to go, and they told us when they're coming. And we've had people from Puerto Rico this summer. It's just been a really intriguing summer. We've had more people visiting than we ever have. So it's been great. We try to have our exhibits relevant to everyone in the county. Our 70s exhibit hits all the communities, all the towns. We included artwork from our Stevens County schools this year. So we had student art. And of course we preserve historical artifacts, which you already know. And we also provide a spot for gathering meetings. We've had SCEIC has met their board at the museum the last couple months. We've had two class reunions this year. They specifically came to see the 1970s exhibit. So we're a busy place. We feel that we're a very important and relevant resource in our community. We feel that we bring people to our community that, like the guy from Brewster, I'm sure he ate somewhere and got gas somewhere, and maybe he bought something somewhere, and maybe he saw something he didn't even know was here. So we're always grateful to be that resource. So last year we received 72,000. We are asking for below cost of living, 2%, to help pay for rising utility costs. So that would be 73,440. And when Cheryl was talking about different people that have loans with them, we are one of them.
I see that.
We have $104,000 to pay our SCEIC loan. We made a payment this year already, so we're fortunate to be able to do that.
So I attend those historical society meetings, and I really appreciate the way Cam has taken the museum out to the different communities. And one way she's done that has been the walking tours that she did last year, and then also the annual meeting. She rotates around the different towns, which is nice to get people out in the different small communities. So,
and we have a bus tour in the fall, so that's coming up. Today's the first day for members. It's the first week is members only sign up. Little perk of being a member. So that's in Framness Township this year.
And then tell them what Thursday night is.
So this Thursday night, we have Paul Watsky come in to talk about his grandfather who found an Arrowhead collection and where he found that, and just some of his family history that is four generations deep in business here. And then September, we have Trunks and Treasures. So that one is about the immigration trunks that we have in our collection and stories around trunks and all of that.
So how many employees do you have? And I suppose you're...
Three part-time employees.
Three,
is that... I'm part-time.
Really? Mm-hmm. And then you have try to be volunteered.
We have very faithful volunteers.
That's wonderful.
That come.
And a lot with three part-time people.
Yes. Considering that... my 32 hours a week includes taking care of the building itself, the grounds, the schoolhouse. As you can see, it needs help. There's some issues there. And then just the programming, the exhibits, the newsletter, the posts. So it's a lot to squeeze in 30 seconds. So we had a really good compliment recently, though. I'm going to leave out the county name that this person used, but he said he was from about 40 miles away. And he said, after he looked through our exhibits, he said, "You guys have a 2023 Cadillac here." Compared to the 1976 Buick that X County has. And I was like, well, that was an interesting way to compliment, but I received that as a compliment. So,
yes.
Yeah.
I have to say, Kim, that the walking tours that you have, I have several leaflets that I pass out to people with the business that I have, and they have come back and told me what a wonderful thing it was that they could do this walking tour in this railroad town that started back many, a long, long time ago, and see these historical homes that are on Park Avenue. Mm-hmm. And the history, that's what they found so interesting, the very detailed history of who built it and where they were and what their occupation was. And so this was very helpful. I mean, it was very good. So I will keep wanting more of those.
Thank you.
Comments, questions?
Any other questions?
Okay. Thank you, Kim.
All right.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Matt, good morning.
Morning. Right here. Hello.
You. I'm gonna go to the next one.
Next one?
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you.
Yep.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yep.
Good morning.
Everybody knows me, and I know everybody here. I guess I'd like to start thanking you guys for coming to some of you that were able to go attend our tour last month. Hopefully it was informational. I gave you an on-the-ground look at what we do with some of this money. So I handed you two handouts. We can start with the single pager. That just is just a little highlight, basically, of who we work with on a day-to-day basis, year in, year out. You know, the Palm Detour Watershed Project, the Boyd, Sioux, and the Chippewa, those are big parts of what we do. They have been for the last almost a decade now. Palm Detour, we are the major player in that. It's half of our county. Boyd, Sioux, we are active, and now the Chippewa will be coming online sometime next year. TSA, we host an engineer here for the TSA, which is just a technical service area. So we have somebody in-house that sits right down the hall from me that plans those engineering projects. That's really advantageous for us because we can get a lot of work done having him stationed here. And he basically sits in our office at no cost. I mean, it's a net gain for us to have him sit there. So that's a bonus. The buffers, you know, we're through the heart of the buffer implementation. We do have one holdout still, I think, that now is with the county where that's at, but the rest of it, we're just doing ongoing compliance now, trying to make sure it's still in place.
Was that all that's left? Is one?
Just one. Yep.
Okay.
Yep. Just one. And then some services. I mean, you guys know a lot of this. You know, we do pretty much our two big expenses are paying people, personnel to be there, and the other is cost share. We put out hundreds of thousands of dollars of cost share every year to local landowners projects. You know, and for every dollar, we've done some figuring that we put out with contractors, about $15 comes back to the county. So you know, that you get them into the county, they're spending money. I mean, it's a bonus for And then education outreach. We do a lot of education. We try to hit every kid from pre-K all the way through grade 12. You know, we have the state Envirothon coordinator in our office, so we coordinate that, which is a statewide effort. You know, co-do Waterfest with Polk County. We do conservation days up at Swell. You know, you're getting 300 kids from fifth grade and sixth grade at those days. And then we do some in-school stuff, also different events. You know, you guys funnel through AIS funding, which is state funding to us. We have family fun night. We've had it out at the last 3 years. We've moved that around, just promoting that. Soil health, you know, radio stuff, Hortonite, we're just, we try to get ourselves out there and do education for a lot of these things. And then some other things that we also administer, the AIS program, like I said, the water quality certification program. I do wetland enforcement with WACA, walking access programs, and I'm also the county ag inspector, weed inspector for you guys at no charge. And then just a little snippet here. The last year we spent and encumbered about $350,000 of cost share, utilizing local contractors, like I said, leveraging about $15 for every dollar grant money. We've done two shorelines in the last year. We have two more pending, a couple rain gardens with three that are on the books pending, sediment dams, which you saw a lot of those are really hard to grasp until you actually go out and see what they are. But they're a huge benefit to landowners. We've done 16 and have another 12 pending. And then I have 50 alternative tile intakes that are on the books to get done. And we also do a lot of things with the other building we're located. If you don't know, in the UFC building. So we have the federal partners on the other side. CRP is a big thing. They are low staff. So we do a lot of that. John has done 21 contracts this year, just this year for CRP, which over the life of that 10-year contract will bring in $1.5 million to the county. And then these last two things are just an easier way to see how things work with a couple charts. It kind of breaks down. We have a dashboard, we call it, which we put in all our funding, and it kind of spits out, hey, this is where you're at. So we're in pretty good shape right now with our fund, I would say. You know, if the door is closed today, we could continue to operate for about 9 months. Not 2 years ago, we didn't even have 2 months worth of funding. So, and a lot of that is just due to being short staffed. We've been down at least one person. We were down two, and billable rates. So the more of these grants that we spend from the One Watershed, One Plan, everything is based on a billable rate that Bowser requires us to do. So you take your hourly rate plus all your overhead. So every time we can bill for time, we're accruing some of those dollars.
So are you trying to recruit to fill those positions or?
Well, yeah, and I'll get to that. Yeah, we did. We actually filled one. We had one person move up to the research stage. So we actually had an intern, Brady Cardwell, a local kid from Donnelly that graduated college, is now our assistant technician.
Okay.
We've Dominic is our district technician. So we're full there, but we still have one vacancy that we haven't refilled. We've just been kind of covering. And now the Pomme de Terre, I guess I can bring it up now. The Pomme de Terre has, we've housed the coordinator for the Pomme de Terre for probably a decade, I suppose. The last one she quit, she moved on to a federal job in Fergus Falls. So there's discussion of doing several different things with this position. Our stance is we'd like to keep somebody here, housed here. Mm-hmm. We are the heart of the Pomme de Terre watershed. We comprise
and we're the fiscal host.
And we're the fiscal host, correct? Yep. We've always done the dollars. Yep. You know, there's some thoughts of combining because Chippewa is coming down the pipe. Like I said, next July they'll probably be funding there. There's talk of doing a combined person, half Chippewa, half Pomme de Terre, but that would then house the Pomme de Terre person in probably Polk County, which isn't even in the Pomme de Terre watershed. So we would like to keep a person there. They're thinking it might be just a part-time person. So
the reason for the difference in the coordinator timing is because they used to have competitive grants that they had to seek out, and now it's pretty much guaranteed funding from one source.
Clean Water Fund that acts, there was a pool of money that we'd apply for every year competitively.
Right.
Now Bowser is shifting things from competitive to this one watershed, one plan. So they take this money and kind of allocate it out based on county size. And so there's less of that to do. So it's with just that, that's kind of a part-time deal. My feelings are there's money we could probably add some duties to this position to make it a full-time thing. Our thoughts, if we do a part-time position, that we do like 50% on the tear, 50% soil health, like an area soil health person. There's $30 million coming down the pipe from Bowser for soil health.
Hard to hire part-time anyway.
I mean, right, you can just hire a part-time person. It's hard to hire a full-time person.
Yeah, so a little part-time.
You've got to find the right
person. There's no benefit.
Yeah, so that's kind of where we're at. That's one of the big things on our plate right now is getting that figured out. And we're working through that with the Joint Powers Board of Chiefs on in Pomme de Terre and the Joint Powers Board in Chippewa. So we're hoping to keep that person there because it's a big bonus for us. The other item here is just our budget, kind of detailed proposed budget. A lot of it is just a really wide estimate, guesstimate, because a lot of this funding we don't know as it comes. We don't know what we're going to do for the year, you know, next year for trees or native grass. So the green column on the right would be this year's proposed budget. Like I'm not going to, like you all can read if you have questions, you know, some highlights. The county grant, if you go down about halfway through the page, that's where you guys come in line. County grant, that's the application. You know, we've been at 110. This year I have in 124.4, and I talked with Beck a little bit about this a month or so ago. I guess for the allocation portion, it would be somewhat considered an increase, but another big major change is there is no local capacity any longer. We got the capacity grant that had a match department.
We are sure.
That is gone. There is now SWCD aid. So finally, we have some stable funding that basically just comes to us from the state, basically like any other aid. We don't have to do reporting. We don't have to do work. You know, we don't have to do any of all the headache that we've had to do. So it's not additional money. It's just a change. We do get a little, there's a little bit of bump. We do get a little bit more with the aid than we did with the capacity. But
the 14.4 is what we used to do.
That's what we used to do, just as the match for that aid.
Two different line items.
Right. Yeah. I think you might have taken that out of riparian or somewhere. Yeah. You just pulled it some another pot. So I lumped that in there. The last time we got an increase was 16 years ago, 2008. And 106,500 was what we got in 2008. And since then, it's been for the last 16. So I mean, we haven't asked for an increase. And like I said, this would be an increase on that line item, but as a tool, it would be the same.
You're saying that capacity went away. So
the capacity would be the
line. And
correct.
Right.
You know, moving down, this CREP technician funding is probably 8 lines down there. That was our Farm Bill Tech, and then they moved it to CREP, which is a RIM program. We use that. That pays for one of the positions. That's a zero. We aren't getting that this year. So that's a hold the bill of about $50,000 that we use for some staff time.
So was that made up elsewhere, Matt?
Well, we had it. It's gone now for this year. We got it in 2003. It won't be coming for this next year. So we'll have to make that up somewhere. Right? Because that pays. John basically does the CREP stuff, which is all RIM. You know, we have 200 RIM easements in the county, which they're doing different things, and CREP is still active. So there is some of that. And I think Bowser reimburses us $30 per easement in the county. So, and we have to go out and do site checks on those things here. So we go backwards on that as well. When you figure in fuel and staff time and whatever, but I mean, we try to keep up with them because we don't want them to end up being like all the WPAs and WMAs and all the other things in the county that are sorely like not good shape. So
Matt, I have a question on state revenue, the top line 261, 388.
Top line.
That's a pretty large increase.
Yeah,
and so, I see your state revenue is up $280,000.
Correct. So yeah, that line item, the Clean Water Fund, PETRA, Board of Sioux, the reimbursement. So what I did there is just I closed out basically what we have left for the grant. So we have some of that grant. That's project. So, and I don't know,
Like that's different every year.
It's different every year. Like last year, it's not going to be 47,770 this year. That was what I budgeted. It's going to be significantly more than that. So this is based on if we spend all what we have left in our two pots, that's what we're going to go through. And that isn't, that's just paying cost year. And we also, an unknown, like I said, Chippewa next year. Chippewa is getting $2.1 million for WBIF, that watershed. We're a small part of the watershed. We'll get a piece of that. What it is, I don't know. So finally, we'll be covered then with the Terrebonne, Deschutes, and Chippewa. So we'll have funding for every part of our account through WBIF. And there should be some staff out of that as well. But that's it. Again, like I said, it's on the process. And you go to the bottom of the page, the TSA, that I'm talking about, Steve, our engineer. So line item 145 I budgeted this year. That's what we get reimbursed for having him in our office. So that covers all his staff time, his vehicle, his travel, plus it's a net positive for us having him there. Nothing else really stands out. Personnel, you know, we've been down with salaries, we've been down people. So depending on where we end up going, that can be up or down, but we've been under at or under budget with that.
But Matt, good stats. If they were 50% Palme du Terre, that 50% would come from the Palme du Terre, the WBIF.
Right. Yeah, there's admin dollars in those WBIF grants. And that's, so actually a lot of the county burden would be reduced because like all admin. Obviously, there's still things that you can't pay for out of it, like leaves and expenses and some other things, but it's wouldn't have to pay for any staff. That's the whole threat. And then the last part basically is the expenses for projects, and that depending on how many people we get in for trees or how many people we can drum up for rain gardens or native grass plantings, that just varies what those are. So,
but those are all grant funds too.
Well, that's
to cover those.
No, that's how we make our money, planting trees, planting grass. That's not a grant. So if I have 50 people come in and want to do tree plantings versus 20 people that want to come in and do tree plantings, or so that's our charges for services. You know, we do mowing, clipping, that kind of thing. So that's how we, that's our only means of making money, basically, is getting on doing the And I just found out today that AIS is going to be $19,250 this year. They just literally sent it this morning. So
that's about the same as we've been
reading. That's, I think, exactly what it was last year. Okay. Yep. So that doesn't usually change because that's based on water bodies, the number of parking spots, and
we don't get ramps much because we don't have much water.
So. Right. Yep.
Okay. Questions for Matt?
No.
Well, the other thing I did forget to mention. We'd be interested in re-upping. We had a 3-year agreement with you guys, I think, for preparing aid for covering some of the buffer maintenance costs. We get, I think, it'll be just shy of 25. So that expires this year. We've done, we did 25 a year for 3 years. And this is the last year of that. And that's reimbursable. So you don't pay that out to us. That's, if we incur the cost, we send back.
Yeah. About November, we do a check in to see if you guys have had any costs, and they've been billing up to about $25,000 on a reimbursement basis.
A reimbursable deal. So. Yeah.
Thank you, Matt.
All right. Thank you.
Good morning. Two agenda items this morning. The first is warrants. I'm sure Inan did review this morning before today's board meeting. The total is $91,594.96. Again, $91,594.96.
I'm sure I move that we pay $91,594.96.
I'll second that.
Motion and second to pay the human services warrants in the amount of $91,594.96. Any other questions, comments? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries.
Thank you. And then the second agenda item is a 2024-25 contract with amended. I did include the contract due to a rate increase. $55 and more this year, so I'm requesting approval for the contract of 24-25.
And what was it?
$52.50.
All right, is there a motion to approve that contract?
I'll make that motion.
A second.
A motion and second to approve the contract. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carried.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Stephanie, good morning.
Okay, the first of the auditor warrants. Are there any questions?
I have none.
Okay. Move on to the commissioner warrants. Hey, did you have any questions?
Something.
Okay,
I'm here. Oh, just on the bottom of page 16,
which A-day.
Commissioner warrants.
Oh, we're going to look for the commissioner warrants?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yep, I didn't have any other.
Bottom of page 16.
County did 16 petitioner legal fees?
Yes. So that's the fees that Wolf Tiling had for to do the petition and everything. And so once the project becomes a project that we take it on, then we reimburse them for the fees that they
okay.
I have a question on page 8, and I don't know if you'll be able to answer. Environmental Scientific for $12,045 for a wetland delineation report.
It's the next week's project.
Yep. That's for Road and Bridge
for next year's projects.
Oh, next year's okay.
Yep.
I was gonna okay.
Yep.
Thank you. Then I did have one other one, page 12.
Okay.
Myers Electric rewire welder outlets in the shop. I'm just.
I would call it a wire upgrade.
Oh.
Wiring upgrade.
Wouldn't carry it.
Huh?
Didn't. Have it wired properly.
Is that it wasn't a large enough capacity.
That's what I mean. Yeah.
Tripping the breaker.
That load.
Yep.
Okay.
Wasn't that designated?
Is that a Swirsky plan?
That would be an engineering design issue, yes.
Thank you.
Okay. Other question?
Okay, I'll take a motion on the commissioner's mark.
I'll move, Madam Chair.
Motion and second to approve the commissioner warrants. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Thank you.
Okay. Next, we have a County Ditch loan pay down. So, County Ditch 16 received partial bond proceeds of $39,600 for the good faith deposit. The remaining proceeds will receive tomorrow. So I'd like to do a loan payment of $25,000. And with that payment, the current balance is $132,300.
Madam Chair, I will make that motion.
I'll second.
So motion and second to approve loan payment to County Ditch 18 from County Ditch 16 and the amount of...
To County Ditch 18. Oh, sorry.
Yep.
Sorry. Yes.
In the amount of $25,000. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries.
Okay. Next in your packet is the pay request number one for County Ditch 16.
I'll make a motion to pay $301,433.69.
Second.
Ag Tech.
Motion and second to approve the payment to Ag Tech in the amount of $301,000. $301,433.69 for the County Ditch 16 project. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries.
Okay. Next in your packet is a continuing disclosure agreement. This is to renew our agreement with Northland Securities to provide our continuing disclosure services. So the base fee is $1,250, and then each bond issuance, it's $250. But we have six bonds that require the reporting. Our private placement one that we have for County Ditch 5 is not required for the continuing disclosure reporting. So, and then the fee will be split between the two for the debt service, which would be for the courthouse and the highway facility. And then the other ones, the ditches will pay their appropriate fee for the report. And this is something, so they report, you know, our debt and make sure that everything is kosher. So I need a motion to approve the dissemination of an agent agreement with Northland Securities.
Madam Chair, I move on that.
I'll second.
Motion and second to approve the dissemination agent agreement with Northland Securities. Any other discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries.
Thank you. So the next is we have 10 pole pads that we use in the city of Morris for the polling locations. Apple is no longer going to support the operating system for those pole pads.
These are not that old.
No, they are not. We have eight of them are Gen 5s and two of them are Gen 6s. But I thought that we could get by using them for the PNP in March, but we cannot. They can't guarantee that something can happen. So, and you can't do anything else with them. I mean, we can't wipe them, wipe them clean and, you know, sell them or anything like that. For one thing, they were purchased with grant money also when we first bought them. So we need to replace those. So in your packet is a quote for $4,765, which includes a buyback credit of $160 for the full pack. So we will get everything will be new except for the printer that prints out the little receipt. That printer is fine. But we'll get a new pole pad, a new case, and a new stand that it swivels on, okay, which is called the slide. Legislation passed a bill that is allocating us election funding now every year. So throughout the state, we got $1.25 million, and 20% of that went equally to all the counties, and then the rest was allocated based on your registered voters. So Stevens County received $4,341.35. Now we get to keep a portion of that because the county just gets to keep a flat 50% of it, and then 25% of to the entity or the jurisdictions that handle all the ABs, and we handle all the absentee ballots for all the taxing jurisdictions. And then the remaining 25% gets allocated to the cities and townships in the county based on their registered voters.
Whether they do their own elections or not.
Correct. Yep. Okay. Yep. It's flat, 25%. So then what I did is I sent a letter to the cities and the townships letting them know what their allocation will be. So there was $1,085 and some odd cents that needed to be allocated to them. So I let them know what their portion would be, and I asked them if they would like to keep their portion or if they would like the county to keep the portion to update and maintain the election equipment and our election administration expenses. So when I typed this up, I had not heard from any, and I've heard from four now that they want the county to keep the money. So I'm hoping I'll hear, you know, from all of them that I'm thinking the city of Morris will probably want to keep their portion. Because I mean, they do have, you know, they do have expenses. They have expenses for election judges and maintaining stuff at the polling location. So they, I mean, they do have some expenses. And then we have to report on this every year of how we spend this funding. So we have our first report is due December of 2024, which will include 23 and then.
And so you're thinking of using some of this money for the polling?
So I would like to use all of this. I mean, right. So the, you know, for sure our 3,256 and then whatever the other, you know, townships or, you know, cities, they don't allow us to keep it. I will use it towards this, these pole pads.
So you need a motion to approve the purchase of 10 pole pads from No Ink in the amount of $4,765.
I do. Yes.
Thank you, Don.
Second.
Thank you, Bob. Motion and second to approve that motion. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries.
Okay. Next is the Hancock Tax Foundation property. So I contacted Paul Carlson, superintendent of the Hancock Public School, and told him that we would be willing to sell the property to them for $10,000. And he got back to me and said that they are not willing to pay that amount.
What was the value? Was it 36 or something?
30.
It was in the 30s.
30 or 37.
It was, yeah.
I think it was 30,000. He mentioned that, you know, they will probably have at least another 10 to 15,000 or more to clean up the lot, you know, to remove the house, to get, you know, get the lot bare and put gravel and everything in it. He did mention that there's a couple easements that they have to deal with. There's the alley. There's an alley easement there. And also there's a utility easement there that his plan was that they'd like to have the, you know, the original bus garage and this new parcel be one parcel eventually, you know, and have one, I think, big, you know, bus garage, not have two separate. So he wanted me to come back to you to ask if you guys would consider lowering the amount. So I broke down. So the actual taxes that were abated were $2,275.02. The interest, $2,275.02. The interest and the penalties were $1,558.93. The cost that we had in serving and publication were $243.17. And then our solid waste assessment was $320. So if you total those up, that's $4,397.12.
That's the least we can give.
Well, this is it. So whatever you choose to sell it for. So say you sell it for $5,000. Say we go back and say, okay, we'll sell it for $5,000. What I do is I take $243.17 and the $320 for the solid waste off the top, and whatever's remaining, 60% goes to the county, 20% goes to the city of Hancock, and 20% goes to the school district. That is how we distribute any tax forfeiture proceeds. So the school will get a little bit back, but that's so. And then the city of Hancock, you know, had $4,962.98 of unpaid bills. I don't know what they are going to do. I don't know if their council will waive those unpaid bills or if they'll want to put the assessment on that property. Whoever.
Weren't they interested also? The city?
They were interested also.
Okay.
Yes. I don't, you know,
but the way I understood it, their interest was so that it didn't go to tax forfeiture. They wanted to make sure that there was an opportunity for someone to buy it, even if it wasn't them.
Right. So what the city would do is they want to make sure that it gets cleaned up.
Yeah.
You know, and they're going to have the same, you know, they're going to have the same costs of cleaning it up also. The one thing, with the city is I think their future plan would be try to sell it for a residential lot, which then we could have future taxes. Not saying that's going to happen, but, you know, they're going to end up taking a loss on it.
You don't think they'd work with the school to get that bus garage if they bought it, the Hancock?
They might, but they're going to have costs in it too. You know, they're already out almost $5,000 in unpaid bills. And then if they go and clean the lot.
I just would think also, that the city council would think that bus garage would be a great improvement for their school system.
I just
can't believe that they'd hope, in the hope that somebody might build a house there.
So I told them I'd come to you guys and see if you would consider lowering the amount.
So the other option is put it up on the sale.
Yeah. Yep. And we wouldn't be able to put it up on a sale for 6 months because
there was interest. Sure.
Yep. 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 And it holds it for 6 months from a public sale.
We do a little bit of talking, but I mean, I think you, I mean, we have costs in there, and those interest and penalties pay for staff and other staff's time. And I think that they're,
you
know, being the best interest to try to recruit the taxes, if at all possible. We've held properties and had to clean them up too. Mm-hmm. So we know that there's costs there. We're not doubting that, but I think, you know, the taxes are important to get back if we can.
So he didn't indicate what they're willing to pay.
Kind of, but.
Oh, you're not going to go there?
Yeah.
All right.
What are the board doing?
With $5,000, we'd cover everything that we need to do.
Is that a motion?
I'll make a motion for $7,500.
Yeah. I guess I'll second a motion for $7,500.
Okay, motion and second to. Put the sale price for the lot in Hancock at $7,500. Any other discussion?
To the school.
To the school.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Any other discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
Okay. And if they decline, do you want me to reach out to the city or do you want me to come back to you guys first?
The city.
Yeah.
City. Just, okay. You know, okay. Can't barter forever, right?
Is the school aware that they get that percentage back?
Okay. No, I think.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Vicki, good morning.
That closer. Read. Thank you.
Good morning. In your packet is a quote for Wasabi Cloud Storage. We're looking at this as a solution to some of our backups to have offsite data recovery. Part of this storage actually gives us some protection too for cases such as ransomware that we can utilize their, what they call immutable storage, which would lock down our backups so that they can't be changed by our systems or outside systems. So that's kind of works with the current backup software that we're using today. So that's what this is giving us. It is a 3-year agreement for 25 terabytes of storage. They did give us an option for 1 year, but looking at the cost, it was significant more to do year by year versus the 3 years. My plan would be to use part of my large equipment budget to pay for this. I have not used part of that funding yet this year, and part of that was going to go towards replacement of on-site storage. I think considering kind of the environment we're in right now, that this would be a good option.
So explain to them what how current backup is done so they know.
Currently we have what they're called network attached storage devices here on site that are each 25 terabytes. We do, you know, backups on both our county law networks nightly, daily, and then we do some weekly stuff. We also do an RDX drive that is detached from the network after it copies a backup. So we do have totally what they call like an air-gapped backup that does sit off our network. And we have 3 weeks time frame for that. So we have 3 tape rotations. So we can go back 3 weeks.
Do we still use M files?
Yes.
And where are they stored?
That's through our backup system.
Okay.
Yeah, all of that stuff, like all of our virtual servers, so all of our, you know, file servers, any of our application servers.
So if we were attacked, could they get at our M files too right now?
Right now, yes.
Okay.
I mean, those servers, that's what those network like air gapped backups are for. You know, the ransomware that we're seeing now can get to anything. I mean, that's, you know, that's where this, I don't think, is necessarily totally safe from that either. The immutable storage piece should be, but the way some of this stuff is evolving, I don't know. I mean, that's kind of a big question. We don't know what the next kind of ransomware is going to be either, but this gives us at least a little more coverage and options.
So this would be like one more, it'd be like a third tier offsite, hopefully. Yeah. Segregated.
And, you know, not even just ransomware, but, you know, with the storms that we had last year too, I mean, that's a big piece that, you know, we pushed some stuff to Highway when we added a server out there last year with their new building, but that's not far enough really for, you know, a natural disaster. So this would help with that too. But if something catches, we have something off site.
Okay. I need a motion to approve. Yeah.
I'll make that motion. To approve the 3-year contract with Asavi for cloud storage.
Second.
Motion and second to approve the payment for a 3-year contract with Asavi Cloud for $6,169.12. All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Thank you, Mickey. Bill, good morning.
Good morning. Planning Commission met on August 7th to review a conditional use permit application for Tim Springer of Dynamic Retrievers. He wished to operate a commercial kennel as required in Section 9C.9 of the Stevens County Zoning Ordinance. The Springers wish to purchase a 22.91 acre farm site in Section 23 of Brentsville Township and operate a kennel to house and train 30 hunting dogs and excavate a pond in a type one wetland for training of the dogs. They would convert an existing outbuilding into a climate controlled insulated indoor kennel to provide comfort for the dogs and lessen the noise of any barking dogs. The kennel will be surrounded by a fenced area for the dogs to exercise and do their business. A septic holding tank will be installed to handle dog waste and be pumped by a MPCA licensed septic maintainers. The excavation of the pond will need to meet Bowser and DNR wetland construction standards for excavating the type one wetland. The wetland design will need to be submitted to the SWC for Wetland Conservation Act technical evaluation panel review of the plan for approval. Most of the training will occur during 7 a.m. to 9 p.m., 7 days a week, and includes duck calls, whistles, to communicate with the dogs, and use of propane-fueled devices to simulate sounds of gunshots. Most of the training is planned for the months of May through September of each year. So at the meeting, the Planning Commission on a 5-0 vote recommends that the County Board approve the conditional use permit with conditions as presented. I will note there was no opposition at the hearing. And I have provided with your packet information, the Planning Commission report to the County Board, a memorandum talking about the Commission report and recommendation to the county that describes the application request, background information, County Board direction, the action taken by the Planning Commission. The proposed findings of facts that were considered in recommending or denying the request. And then I also listed the recommended conditions discussed at the hearing that night. Another document that provided is finding the fact criteria with proposed findings that the Planning Commission approved and recommend for approval to the County Board. And also listed there are the conditions that were considered at the hearing that night. The rest of the information that was provided for you was portions of the Springer application request and some aerial photos that I provided of the area from the kennel and the proposed pond area, as well as some aerial photo shots using a drone of the farm site itself, and then the type one wetland that looks towards the So I guess I'm here to have the board act on the planning commission.
I have one question on the conditions. Number seven, if noise becomes a nuisance from dog training at the pond area, who determines that?
Well, actually, there are noise regulations. Let's go to 73.
Yeah, right. I read that.
Yeah, that's there. So if it's proven that the noise level there is above a certain decimal level for a certain time of the day and period of the day, then that requirement will be looked at as far as something needs to be planted.
And I was at that hearing that night, and they actually talked about that specific thing. And the reason why they changed it to this instead of making them plant trees was because it's in a swampy area, and they didn't figure the trees are going to grow anyway, you know. So, and the proof that Mr. Springer had presented as far as the noise decibel levels wasn't going to come anywhere close to the nearest neighbor. So the planning commission didn't think it was going to be an issue, but they wanted that provision in there just in case in the future it did become an issue. So
yeah, Mr. Springer provided some comparison between a 12-gauge shotgun as well as their propane fuel simulators. And I can definitely tell the difference, and you probably do, Jeannie, between the two videos that we had here, that was definitely less noise using the simulators than the shotgun.
I'll make a motion to approve the conditional use permit.
Second.
Motion and second. Do I need to read the special conditions, or is that just okay?
Unless you wish.
No. Okay. Motion and second to approve the conditional use permit for Dynamic Retrievers LLC. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries.
Can you sign
that
initial
list, Judy? Yeah.
This would have been recommended for hybrid poplars that are supposed to grow like our hybrid willows that are supposed to grow like 6 feet a year.
Whoa. We should keep that in mind.
Yeah.
Well, it depends on what soil type to die.
Yeah.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you. Becky.
All right. So I've got a couple of things here. I've got donations for approval. We have a couple of different donations that I'm asking the board to consider today. There is some donations for the ongoing vest that the posse is trying to raise for. So that is for a total of $1,100. $1,100 to be receipted into the sheriff's account to be used for those bullet process for the posse.
Make the motion to approve the donations of $1,100.
A second. Motion and second to approve the donations of $1,100 into the sheriff's account for vests. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries.
All right, thank you. And then after the request for the community letter went out from the board, we did receive $5,050 in donations for the daycare efforts. So I'd like a motion to accept those donations for that effort.
Madam Chair, I move to accept the $5,050 for daycare.
I'll second that.
Motion and second to approve the donation of $5,050 for the daycare pods. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries.
Thank you. All right. The next thing we have in your packet is the final retainage, a release of retainage for approval on the daycare project. We did hold 5%, and then they did submit documentation as well as there's a one-year warranty period on the property. So we are looking for approval to release the $50,000 to Apollo Development. You would see in the packet that there's a temporary occupancy permit, and we're just doing this meeting to be complete to request the final occupancy, but that's good for the end of the year.
Madam Chair, I move to pay Apollo the retainage of $50,000 for the day.
I'll second that.
Motion and second to pay Apollo Development the 5% retainage in the amount of $50,000 for the daycare project. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries.
Thank you.
Did you get the appliance stuff worked out?
Yes. Good. Well, we think they're fixed. We're waiting for folks to try them out, run with their load. Yes. Okay. I'm wondering, in the interest of time, if we can move a couple of these items to the end, or do you want me just to go ahead and okay. I did include a summary of all the HR changes that were effective as of this legislative session. I included those in your packets. I don't know if you guys had a chance to read those, if you have any questions. A lot of it is, you know, postings that are included. Like there was you said the first one, there's a posting of veterans benefits and services. That is supposed to be a poster that's created by the commissioner. We're assuming the Department of Labor, and that will need to be posted January 1, 2024. So that's just an internal. I kind of included everything that we talked about as a administrator association, just so you guys could see the breadth of what was changed, but some of them aren't huge issues. The second one there is regarding data privacy. It was amended to require employers to provide personnel data to the union so that they can investigate and process grievances. That's effective August 1st. So not necessarily a cost add, it's an administrative burden, time piece of it. The Public Relations Act was amended, Public Employee Relations Act, is amended to include staffing ratios, and this has been interpreted to assume that employees may have the opportunity to discuss staffing ratios during negotiations, minimum staffing levels for office and operations. This has been something that's been an inherent managerial right for as long as we can remember. So I think there's some challenges there potentially. I think that an option there for the board is to go back and look at what our continuity of operations include for minimum staffing ratio should we have a catastrophic event, and therefore kind of establish what we would interpret to be minimum staffing ratios. That could have long reaching impacts. We haven't seen or heard of anybody right now that's actually actively negotiating, and that we don't have to negotiate till the end of next year.
So is that new, allow time off to assist an affiliate? Is that new?
That is new. Yep.
Okay.
An affiliate. So we always had to allow time here for representation on grievances and other personnel issues. So like somebody representing, helping somebody else in the unit. This is to actually go to another affiliate. It's like another bargained unit represented by that. Yeah. Payroll deductions. So there are a couple of them above that payroll deduction one, that we used to be able to require authorization proof so we could do that payroll deduct. We're not allowed by law to do deducts of other people's pay unless it's been authorized by the employee. So standard procedure was to request signatures proving that that payroll deduct was authorized. We can no longer require that. Or we have to take their word for it. The personnel data piece under that act, limited public employee personnel data is public. However, new legislation will require county to provide following information in an Excel file to the union business agent within 20 calendar days of start in the bargaining unit. In addition to that, the county is also required to provide that same information for every 120 days to union representative. Again, this is a big It's a big administrative burden in terms of all the units providing that routinely. It must be in an Excel file that says, calls that out within the law. We have to notify the union within 20 days when an employee separates. We've already got a process for that. We're doing that routinely. That's not huge. We must disseminate data to unions to investigate and process grievances. We've already talked about that a little bit. August 1st, 2023, notify union and new hires and terminations and transfers within 20 days. So that is, there's just a lot of administrative burden with processing and pushing that data consistently. We could We should also, and I think Jan was looking at this just to make sure our tenants, so we give a Tennyson warning when they sign all their employment paperwork that we can disseminate data as needed or requested by other partners. So that would be modified probably within our Tennyson warning that we have that legal obligation to do that every 120 days. And that as a part of that, the legislative changes, we will be routinely doing that on that employee because we're releasing some of that is not public. It's not public data. So we also have to provide an opportunity paid 30 minutes within 30 days to hire with the business agent to be counseled on their rights. Some employers are taking the position that they have larger counties that maybe have 20 employees coming on during the day. For that month, they take the position that they're going to include that as a part of their orientation. I don't know that that makes sense functionally for us because we usually deal with one at a time and it's not a consistent scheduled start date. It's not like we say the 15th of every month is going to be our new hire date. So I think we're going to work through that a little bit. But they do, they are allowed that 30 minutes of paid time effective August 1st. We must allow union representatives to communicate with members via employer issued email addresses. We've never put a prohibition on that. I think there are a lot of private email addresses that are used, but we've never put a prohibition on that. The next one is the facilities usage. Counties must allow unions to use the facilities owned or leased by the county. They must be for union business only, not for political purposes. You can charge costs for maintenance, security, and other costs. We've allowed those groups to use public rooms as available on the calendar. So that's not a big change for us. The next one is employer cannot require an employee to attend an event that is to communicate the opinion of the employer about religious or political matters. We haven't done that, so we're safe from that one. We wouldn't change our process on that. The next one is the nursing mothers and the accommodations under that act. Jan did already bring updates for that. We had already had a pretty good process in place for that. We had a designated space established and it's been utilized and without conflict. So I think that one wasn't an issue there. The parenting leave and accommodations, removing the requirement that the employee must work 12 months to use this right for pregnancy, birth of a child, conference time, sick and safe time. I will tell you that, this codifies like the requirements under this. I would tell you that the county has generous vacation and sick balance leaves that have been negotiated. So as folks have needed this, we have granted it to the ability that we can. There's also some concurrent implications here, like with federal FMLA. Where we can, we credit that time towards federal FMLA. So just so you know that they'll be granted this leave, although we were doing it in unpaid forms if we needed to. It just isn't, being applied to the FMLA necessarily in every case. Questions on that one? Earn sick and safe time. This is the one that we're going to have a little bit more conversation than just today here, and we'll probably do it at the personnel committee and then come back to the full board. It's effective January 1st, 2024. It means leave, including paid time off and other paid leave systems that's paid at the same hourly rate as the employee earns. I think where this is an issue, it's not with our full-time staff, because as they become new employees, they're accruing that leave fairly quickly, right? But it is for the part-time who work at least 80 hours in a calendar year. So I think, so that's the first piece of it, is it's going to be protected time for those folks that aren't earning leave banks. So we need to be conscious and careful about how we're applying or asking for part-time work. That could have an implication there. In terms of additional costs to the employer that they're not.
This is why you talked about the county highway having a part-time person, correct?
Yep. So they accrue 1 hour of earned sick and safe time for every 30 hours work. So if you have a part-time person for the summer, they're working, 600 hours, that's 20 hours of paid leave, right? So that's where we need to be conscious of how we're looking at the status of future hires that might fall into that part-time category. The other thing that this part of the law does is it broadens the definition of family members, and we've seen this trend in union negotiations, asking for different bundles of folks to be included. I think where it becomes problematic is, you know, as an association, we've always pushed for concurrent language between federal FMLA definition of family members, because it can get, it's administratively can get difficult to administer what your policy is, your contract is, your federal is, and then the state broadens. Yes.
So this sick time,
yes.
1 hour for every 30 hours works. What is it now for our, what is our policy? You know? I'm just,
so it's
is it different, or is that what it is?
It's 1 day a month for sick time.
Okay.
So it's less, 1 hour for every 30 hours worked. They get 8 a month. So if you're working,
full-time employees is like 69 hours at 1 hour per 30 hours.
One per 30, what'd you say was the ratio? Can't do
69 hours in a year.
So we get
on 2,080 hours.
We get 1 day a month. So, you know, like full-time employees get 8 hours a month. The 35-hour employees get 7 hours a month. The 37 and a half get 7.5 a month. So that's a total of 96 hours for the year. So this, our policy is more generous and it exceeds that.
Okay.
So we don't need to grant anything additional, because your qualified leave, is that where you're going? Your qualified leave plans can be
used
for this. Yeah. So we wouldn't need to grant anything additional for our full-time folks. It's more of our part-time folks that you're looking to hire. And then the other piece of it, I think that's challenging, is the expanded definition of family members. And I think we've seen different family units really develop. And so that's really what's pushing this. But it can just get problematic, because you have federal FMLA qualifications, or what definitions of family are. You have state ones, you have your employer policy, and then you've got the union policy. And generally, we like to see consistent language across all those categories, you know, when it comes to use of leave, FMLA, care of a family member, those type of things. So it just, it's a lot to manage. Let's see, what else did I want to say? That so essentially what the law says is that you need to have a policy that meets or exceeds the statute and then maintain. So we'll need to do a policy update for a part-time classification, those not earning leave, and that'll be for January 1st of 2024. The next one is kind of interesting. The county cannot inquire into an applicant's pay history for purposes of determining compensation for the applicant. So I think we're pretty good in our hiring processes. We ask questions like, you know, what wage range are you looking at being placed at? But you can't verify pay history or require that. Para, this changes the vesting to 3 years of service. Pretty significant one. The next one is,
what is it now?
5. For a partial, that's not full. I mean, it's not full vesting in the employer portion, but this is full vesting in the employee. Yeah. Okay. So the para reduction is the next one. So you can reduce the salary if it exceeds $425 in any month, or exceeds annual income of $5,100. There is some language defining what the temporary position is. So I mean, seasonal workers don't necessarily fall into this or temporary, but if you have consistent temporary employees, it's the same person coming back every year, subject to para. There was a PTSD changes. I'm not going to talk a lot about that one. I think that you guys had gotten a pretty good overview through. I know AMC did one on that, but there are some changes really that were into the employer's benefit, and I would say the employee's benefit as well, because really what we want to do is we want to heal somebody who's injured in the line of duty. And this requires and puts in place some parameters and some safekeepings to provide for a path for treatment. Questions on any of those?
Mr. Claybaugh could probably speak to that.
Yes.
CIT, so.
Yep. So I just wanted to give you kind of a breath of what the HR ones. This was a really historic session in terms of a number that we've seen. We haven't seen that many. And for that wide of an area. So some of them are administratively burdensome. Some of them are a little bit cost burdensome, or could have cost risks associated with it. Okay, so the next thing I have on there, if nobody has any questions on that, is the cannabis update. I think there's multiple ordinances that we're going to likely have to partake in, but the one that I think the most important one that the committee met on and felt that the board should discuss setting a public hearing for is for the public use and public spaces. So many local government units are choosing to put such a prohibition in place, similar to what we saw happen with the Tobacco and Clean Air Act. I did attach a sample ordinance that was put out through the Sheriff's Association and the County Attorney's Association, very similar to what we've seen first hearings set on in other surrounding counties. It was asked to reach out to the surrounding counties. One county, a neighboring county, is making a recommendation here, either this meeting or the next, to set a public hearing. The others are just in the process. We need to do some further work as a committee with recommendations to the board on a potential moratorium until that, as we're allowed to under that file. Also maybe some amendments on some of the current ordinances with the T21 ordinance and things like that. But I'm not ready at this time to make recommendations. I would just ask the board consider setting a public hearing for prohibition of use of that in public spaces. We typically, what our process has been, is to been, we do two hearings on readings, although we're required to do one, and then it would go to the paper, get posted for 30 days with no comment. It would become law in Stevens County. So asking the board to, if they have any feedback on that draft ordinance, if they don't, I would ask that you would set a public hearing date for the first and second meetings in September so that I can get those advertised.
So we only need to do one?
Yes. Aaron's recommendation was always to do two, because that gives the opportunity to take comment. And then if you need to make changes to the ordinance, then you would have to have a second reading anyway. So we always just establish.
You can set one and then you can continue it also.
You could do that as well. Whatever the board wishes.
I would have practice. That we set it one hearing for September 5th at 9:30.
I'll second. Go ahead, Donnie.
I'll second it.
Motion and second to set the hearing cannabis policy for September 5th at 9:30 at our county board meeting. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Motion carries.
Did the board want me to run through that? I know you guys had the opportunity to review it. The only other thing that I changed on there is I added jurisdictions to be all of Stevens County unless the local jurisdiction passes a stricter ordinance than what was proposed.
Yeah.
Okay. Out-of-state travel, the next thing I have there is approval for policy for me to travel out-of-state to Milwaukee from August 29th to the 31st. It isn't all paid through NACO. They requested that I participate. It's a County Leaders Academy that they're holding about daycare, and they wanted us to come and report on the project. So,
Madam Chair, I so move.
Thank you. Is there a second?
I'll second.
Motion and second to approve out-of-state travel and the expenses to be paid by NACO for Becky to go to Milwaukee, Wisconsin, August 29th through the 31st. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries.
Thank you. The next thing I have is just asking, I didn't get a chance to send this out. We had an MOU with Grant County, but we are asking that you approve an additional MOU with County Attorney Wilkin County Attorney's Office. It would be the same parameters that we use for Justin Anderson, but he has a heavy workload and might not be able to everything that we need. So it's like in the interim until the positions restaff, to also issue an MOU with Wilkin County to be able to access services through there as well.
Make that motion.
I'll second.
Motion and second to approve the MOU with the Wilkin County Attorney's Office to provide interim county attorney services. All those in favor say aye.
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 Opposed? Motion carries.
Okay. And then we have just a quick personnel committee update. We did meet this morning. We did receive a decline from Carl on that, and we would like to, as a committee, ask the board's permission to go ahead and start negotiating with the second candidate for the county attorney position.
You need a motion for that?
No, consensus from the board that you
go ahead.
Okay.
So then, do we advertise to fill that position at the same time? I mean,
so we haven't had an offer accepted yet. So right. We would. You know, we would have the board's approval to do the backfill if that were successful.
Yep.
Yep.
Okay.
Okay.
16 change order.
Yes. I did hand that out this morning. That did come in.
Yeah, I can speak to that.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Thank you for being patient.
Yes, no worries. Yeah, so I'm Joe Donkers. I'm with ISG, the engineer on the project. I'm here on behalf of Jacob Rischmiller, who is out with his newborn kid. So, so I'm here to speak on the change order. And then we also have Chris Adams online, who runs a lot of our CA stuff. So he can answer some questions if needed. So I'm here on for two change orders. The first is specifically on the railroad cuts. At the time of the final engineer's report, we estimated you're going to bore the entire 150-foot right-of-way easement. This is really to keep it simple and straight, and it's the cleanest approach. Contractors don't really like working within the right-of-way of railroads. In between the time of the final engineer's report and then when we bid this project, we bid other projects for railroads, and we're getting cost estimates pretty high, pretty similar to what we got for 16. Because of this, we tried to work with the railroad to cheapen the bore. As a result, we thought we could shorten the bore to be in the right-of-way, and then we would open cut and install the rest of it, not boring. So really, it was an attempt to cheapen the project. We thought we had an agreement in the fine print that we missed. We didn't know that the entire right-of-way had to be steel pipe. We thought we could put the non-bored pipe as plastic pipe. As a result, it has to be steel. So we talked with the contractor to see what the option would be, the two options being to change it to steel and still open cut it, or option two would be to extend the boring back to the original length. We got two estimates from them. The estimate to open cut and put steel pipe in our opinion, was not reasonable. And then the other option is just to extend the length, which is at the same price that was at the bid for $58,000, which is the cheaper option. So at this time, we recommend just extending the bore to get out of the right-of-way. It's the cheapest option we have. And it kind of falls in line with what was approved at the FEO.
But that was originally bid. The extension?
No. So that was approved at the final engineer's report. However, the cost that we had at the final engineer's report for that bore was
correct.
What we're finding is that no one really wants to deal with the right of way, and all the costs for boring under railroads is significantly higher than boring under state roads. That's where the change order one falls in.
So I have a question on that. So who carries the liability policy for that, for the railroad, for that, for the next 25 years? Or my understanding is that there's a requirement from the railroad that you carry liability insurance for at least 25 years. Yeah. Of how much, I don't know how many dollars. So whose name is that in?
And liability of what, Ron?
Is there something?
I believe it's the county.
Is it the ditch system that carries that, or
yes,
or what?
We had to have extra. We had to buy a policy through the railroad, a liability policy, because I know I reached out to MCIT and they don't have coverage to carry something like that. But the railroad notified us and they offer a policy that we have to have.
There's a conflict of interest.
Well, or so if someone else that represents the railroad. You remember that email?
Yeah, I do remember. Yeah.
Yep.
I'd like to know more about that.
Okay, I will somehow look into more. Yep.
Because I know there's another local person or landowner that has done the same thing, and they had to get that same insurance.
Okay. Yep. Is it awful expensive?
No, I didn't think it was
terrible. I was expecting a lot more.
I want to say off the top of my head, was it like $3,000?
A year?
Yeah, like for the policy. Yeah. I will, yes.
Other questions, comments?
So this goes back to the ditch has to pay for this added cost.
Yes.
So you're going to do the second change order at the same time? Or?
Yeah, so the second change order is really just to give you guys an updated idea for the total cost of the project. In short, we overestimate, we double accounted for a stretch of pipe, a 1,700 feet of pipe that won't be installed and it wouldn't be paid for regardless. This is really just a formality to make sure you guys are aware of the updated cost.
So there'll be a reduction?
There'll be a reduction of 98,000.
So between the two change orders, there's actually a reduction in the cost of the project.
Yes, $30,000.
Well, that helps.
Well, it's not really cheaper.
Yeah,
they made a mistake.
Yeah,
somebody made a mistake.
Yeah, it wouldn't have been installed. So I don't want to fluff it and
act. No, at least it's not.
Yeah,
yeah. At least,
I mean, it's still a 58,000 more.
Exactly.
Plenty of prices, material and installation.
Yes.
Okay.
I don't see we have much choice, but the project can't get done.
No.
Yeah. I guess I don't like people to make the motion to accept the change of it.
Both of them?
Might as well get them both in one, can't we? So, yes.
A second. Motion and second to approve change order one at a cost of $58,371.48, extending the 36-inch flooring, and change order two, the overestimated 36-inch agricultural tile with a reduction to the project of $96,767.37, with a net decrease to the project of $40,429.53. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? I had more discussion.
Sorry.
You got any dust?
So if this 58,000 would have been additional on the final bid, that would have put us over the 30% over the contractor's estimate. So we would not have been able to move forward with the project because we were like really close to that at that time.
Was it over 3%?
No, it was just barely under. It was barely under the 30%, but this would have put it over, so we would not have been able to move forward with it. So
right.
Maybe Jacob made that mistake intentionally.
I will say, we have learned the this project and a couple others, the railroad borings are way more expensive than what we give them credit for. So the several main, if we were to go back and do a new hearing, the several maintenance would have also gone way up too. So it would have been under 30%, but I do understand your comment.
Okay. Yeah,
we did.
Oh, that's right.
We yeah.
Back
and commented afterwards. Yep. All right.
Thank you. Again, thanks for being patient.
Yeah, no worries. I was a little afraid I missed it.
No.
Ron, it was $1,266.
Yeah.
Was the amount of the policy?
Oh, okay.
Hold it now. Just a minute, maybe. I'm going to have to read this.
All right, Mr. Claybaugh.
Okay.
Thank you.
Good morning and welcome, and thank you for being patient.
Yeah, good morning. No, you're good. Thank you for the opportunity to be with you. I'm Garrett Claybaugh, Executive Director of the Minnesota County Intergovernmental Trust. I'm happy to be with you. I've got a handout. You may have gotten this electronically. Yep.
You may have got it.
Yeah. Okay, all right. I've got extra copies if you want that, but I'll take a little bit of time here just to walk through that. I'm not going to read it to you, but get a few highlights along the way. We try to do this once every couple of years, just really to reintroduce MCIT to commissioners, particularly if there are new commissioners coming on board. But you probably know us as your insurer, but in reality, we're your risk pool. And there's a difference. We are a public entity organized as a joint powers entity. So we're a local government and subject to the same laws of the state of Minnesota as you are. Our board is made up of your peers, other county commissioners and other county officials. We have six county commissioners that are serving on our board right now, two auditors and a county administrator. So people who do your work, who are in your seats and appreciate the complexities of managing county government. As a government entity, we're not for profit. So we're not putting monies in shareholders' hands. In fact, when we can, we turn monies back to our members in the form of dividends, and the board's been very consistent about doing that, although certainly the dollar amounts differ from year to year, but I think for over 30 years, the board has done that. So we're happy to do that. And those dividends really grow from two things. One is a better than expected claims experience. So when claims are less expensive or we see fewer claims, that contributes to some of the excess. And then, of course, returns on investment in stock in the bond market that we make our investment from. So all good reasons to return those excess revenues to you. You're never going to see salespeople from MCIT come and knock on your door or on your staff's porch trying to sell you something you don't need. We do have outreach staff, a small field staff, and I'll talk a little bit about them here in a few minutes. You know, we're very fiscally and financially secure, and that's one of the takeaway messages I want to leave with you. And the other is that our interests are aligned with yours. We're really here to serve you and your needs. Your interests are to see fewer claims, less severe claims, and that's our interest. So we can provide training, support, consultation on topics. We're real happy to do that. Let me walk through the handout real quickly, and if you'll jump to page 2, we'll hit a few highlights on the way. In the dark blue box on the top of page 2, about a year ago, we were notified by our cybersecurity insurer, Hartford Steam Boiler, and of course, they were your cybersecurity insurer as well, that we were being canceled, and they were canceling much of their local government business across the country. So it wasn't unique to us or unique to Minnesota. I'm very proud that our staff was able to develop some options in front of our board. And I think the program that we put in place in 2023 to keep that coverage available to you all is actually better coverage than we had a year ago. MCIT is responsible now for adjusting those claims. And so we're taking advantage of the opportunity to really learn what your experience is in that area. So I think that's all a big positive, and I'm proud of our staff. And again, appreciate the board's guidance in sort of keeping our feet to the fire to make sure we've got that option available. On page 2 in that gold box in the lower left-hand corner, it highlights dividends. And these are data from 2022. So last year we paid $7 million in a dividend. And that all came from the workers' comp division in MCIT, nothing from property casualty. I'm sure you've experienced this as you've been constructing roads, buildings, making repairs. The last 3 years has been very difficult on access to supplies, cost of supplies, cost of labor, delays, inflation, very difficult environment. And so we've seen additional claims, and when we've had claims, they're more costly as a result of that. And so the board last year, and they've done that again for 2023, has said the dividends that we're going to pay from will not come out of the property casualty side. Not because we're having financial problems, but because the board is really taking a conservative approach because the environment is just very volatile at this particular time. So last year we paid $7 million in the form of dividends, and Stevens County's portion of that was $35,000. So you'll see in 2023 a distribution of a $4 million dividend in total, and then certainly you'll receive a portion of that. On page 3, I just want to highlight some of the data in these graphics here. This will give you some indication about our relative activities, where we see our claims activity. In particular, the top set of graphs focus on workers' compensation. These data are from 5-year period, 2018 to 2022. And the by frequency section just simply counts claims, regardless of whether they were a zero cost claim or a multi-million dollar claim. But severity counts all of the costs of those claims. So over that 5-year period, you can see that sheriff and jail operations, both by frequency and costs, are expensive, and it's a significant area of activity for us in the area of workers' comp. And I think it makes sense. Your deputies are on the road 24/7, 365, dealing with very difficult situations, and so
and as a consequence, they get injured. So that's a fairly common occurrence in the cost. Highway is the second highest category. And again, I think it makes some sense. Those are also folks that are on the roads in poor weather conditions and doing public work that's very difficult. And so from a workers' compensation standpoint, we see claims in those two areas. The lower section of graphs is the same type of information just for property casualty. So this is our work relating to property insurance. So all of your buildings, the buildings that were kind of part of our book of business, so to speak, we have $7.5 billion in public buildings in our portfolio. And again, if you look by frequency and severity, auto claims are number one. And again, that probably stands to reason. There's 11,000 vehicles in your fleets and the fleets of counties and local governments across Minnesota that we insure. And this has also been an area that's been costly through the course of the last 3 years in terms of doing repairs. Property is the second highest area of activity. You see the number of claims we get, relatively speaking, is much lower. But the blue bar on the right talks about the total costs, very, very high. And again, it stands to reason one building, if this building were to collapse, would be millions of dollars to replace that. So we do see those. And property, again, has been kind of an area where we've seen an increasing number of claims in the last few years and more costly claims. The gold bar along the right side of page 3 just highlights one component of how we calculate your workers' compensation rates. And you'll see there's a 0.735 in that blue box. That's called a mod rate. We compare expected workers' comp claims to what's actually occurring. And if you do better as a member of ours than what you're expected to do, we give you a benefit in reducing your contribution for that year. And so you see this 0.735 is less than one. So you're performing really very well. So that's congratulations to you. You have good safety programs and people that are aware of safe work environments. And so that mod factor results in about a $21,000 savings in your contribution rate. So
I got a question. So PTSD, that falls in that sheriff and jails area, right?
Yeah, I think that would be right. That would be in that sheriff.
And it's a tough thing to manage, isn't it?
Yeah, and you...
How do you pay it off?
And you mentioned, too, there's legislation that passed this earlier this year that addressed PTSD. And I think Rebecca made an indication notes here since I knew this was coming up.
Yep.
The legislation that was passed earlier this year by the Minnesota legislature requires individuals who claim PTSD to go through 24 to 32 weeks of treatment under the old system. Claim could be proffered to PARA, and if they were eligible and began payments, then they would make a claim for workers' compensation as well. And the system didn't require treatment. And of course, especially because labor costs are difficult, but also because we want to put people back to work. That's really kind of a fundamental premise of the workers' compensation program. So I think the legislative change was positive. We'll obviously have to see how that rolls out, how attorneys, how the bar interacts with that new program. But we're continuing to see PTSD claims. It's a cost driver for us. And of course, you know, MCIT, like your work, is we're really doing the right thing for the public. If people are injured and they're due those benefits need to be paid. But at the same time, a premise of workers' comp, as I said, is really returning people to work, really kind of restoring their health, restoring their ability to return to work. And that works to our members' benefits as well, given the labor market. So for a condition that's very treatable, labor shortages, and it's a cost driver, I think the legislation was really in good form, and we'll hope for the best as the implementation begins.
Thanks for explaining that.
And you're welcome. The last page 4, just highlights some of our outreach services, and I just want to hit a few of these as I conclude. You know, we're always available to come out and meet with you. We've got a small field staff, but they do get around the state on a very regular basis. And so we were available for Rebecca and your team here to meet with safety committees, provide advice, whatever we can do to really help effectively control costs and losses. We're happy to do that. The section on the right, upper section, is actually highlighting our website. We just rolled out a new website a couple of months ago, and there's just a real depth of resources on that. We've reorganized them to find them better. We've also begun posting videos. You know, through the course of the pandemic, we all had to do a lot remotely. We got really good at using technology as a way to distribute information. So we're not requiring as often in-person trainings, for example. We still have those, but we've also got videos that we've developed, and they're always out there for to provide information to people. We are doing more webinars. In fact, we had a Minnesota Data Practices webinar a couple of months ago. We had about 20, 25 people in-house at MCIT's offices in St. Paul, but we had about 90 people online taking advantage of that. So that's helpful, I think, for our members as well, because it's reduced travel costs, lost time out of the office, those kinds of things as well. So we're trying to do what we can to be more flexible in developing and distributing that training information. So that kind of concludes my remarks. Again, I appreciate your time that you've provided to us to come in and give you a kind of a reminder of what MCIT is, what we're doing for you, and be happy to answer any questions.
Any questions?
Have anything?
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Appreciate your time again.
Right. Are there any commissioner reports?
I'd support a Hanford Family Partnership and you know, increase there might be a return of some money. Financial people are meeting, and I think we have a very healthy reserve there. So,
cool.
Oh, and we've been having trouble hiring nurses, but I think we've filled a couple positions. It was so bad that we turn away some clients, and of course, in that field, you don't want to be turning away pregnant women.
So, I have great news. Prime West won the appeal.
Oh, I didn't know.
Yeah,
I didn't see it.
Prime West won the appeal, so I don't know what that means for us yet, but that is really great news for Prime West. Great, so good.
They overturned time and money spent there to get something good ahead
for the other plans.
Yep.
So it probably won't impact enrollment like now, but
probably won't this year. But
so then you can go to one single plan as opposed to having to.
And Blue Cross, they may have to move out then. I mean, they put some money into getting into our counties. And if we can have just one plan, I don't know what they tell them. Yeah.
Well, that's awesome. Like I said, I don't know how that trickles down and what it actually means.
On what, when, and how.
Yeah.
That'll be part of the judgment.
We did find out yesterday that we won the appeal.
That's awesome.
Good. I attended County Government 201 for new commissioners, and that was on August 3rd. The classes dealt with constituent outreach and building relationships, and then also another session on open meeting law pitfalls, and also managing board meetings in polarized times. So it was pretty interesting. Also, I'm now serving on Dancing Sky Grant Review Subcommittee on the 2024 Title III requests. So I spent some time with them on August 10th on that committee. So that was very interesting. We gave away a lot of money. So it was, I enjoyed that a lot. That's it.
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
Motion and second to adjourn at 11:33. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries.